it was a weekend of exciting football in action. We saw a victory for Man City, still 100% record this season. We saw a victory for Liverpool against West Ham. It was a share of the spoils in North London. And, you know, borrowing Chipolo's words, it was a letter past my neighbor for Manchester United against Burnley. And then for Chelsea themselves, their struggles continued this weekend. So we're doing a review of all the action we saw this weekend. And of course, Buddy has bragging rights on the show today. We'll tell you why in a bit. Let's just get into it. Let's read out the results from this weekend. It all started on, there were no matches on Saturday lunchtime. Started at 3 p.m. on Saturday. Man City claimed a 2-0 victory over Nottingham Forest despite a red card to Rodri. Luton Town and Wolves shared the spoils. 1-1 that one ended. Crystal Palace played out a goalless draw with Fulham. Everton went to Brentford and claimed a 3-1 victory. First win of the season for Sean Dyche and the Toffees. Manchester United, 1-0 winners over Burnley. I can say United didn't deserve to win that one. That's just me. West Ham were beaten by Liverpool 3-1. That one ended on Sunday. Chelsea, 1-0 losers at home against Aston Villa. Brighton, 3-1 winners against Bournemouth. They came from behind to do that one. Arsenal and Tottenham Hotspur played out a 2-2 draw. And of course, Sheffield United were beaten black and blue at home by Newcastle. 8-0. That one ended. 8 different goal scorers as well in that one. That's the first time in the Premier League era that has happened. 8 goals, 8 different goal scorers. So kudos to Newcastle for that one. There's only one place to start, guys. Let's start from the Malays at Chelsea. But I'll come to you. I'll not go to Chipolo for that one. I'll come to you.
The program will not end.
We can take lamentations from the fans outside. We don't want Chipolo's lamentation in the studio.
I have one request, guys. Two requests. Okay. Please stop saying you want to hear the lamentations of Chelsea fans. Please don't say that. But secondly, is there a way we can beg our technical team to remove Chelsea's highlights from this screen?
You must see. Buddy, what is going on at Chelsea? What went wrong at the weekend?
Simple stuff. At the end of the day, you try control a game so much, and so when you get to the final third, confusion sets in. Look at the 2-1 situation.
Three,
2-1. 2-1.
Right.
Jackson moment. You know, one of those situations as well, and you get to miss that. It's easy to always point a finger at the coach, but the players as well need to look at themselves in the mirror and ask themselves, are we really playing for this manager? Because the results are not just forthcoming. And Chelsea fans have already started, the likes of Trippier have started, poch out. And when you look at the run of games in the next couple of months, Anthony, it doesn't even come any easier. Injuries and what have you, maybe if every player were fit at this point in time, I would say, okay, maybe there's something fundamentally wrong. But even with the players on ground, I think Chelsea should be getting a result against this Villa side, because it wasn't as if Villa were fantastic on the day. But Chelsea didn't just take their chances when they had an opportunity to.
Nicolas, we know Chipolo's position apparently is poch out.
Yeah.
We know Ogazu's position. Ogazu's position has been clear from the start, actually. He's also poch out as well. Always also poch out as well. But is it a case of Pochettino goes and things become better? Is he the real problem of Chelsea, or there are other things deeper that we can, you know, put our finger on right now?
Yesterday, we had this conversation, myself, Triple, and even Buddy. You know, we told Triple that it is not only the coach. I don't think Pochettino is really the problem of Chelsea. Okay, what about the players that came in? What about the players they brought in? See Nicolas Jackson. you can't forgive him. This is like the third time. This guy wants to put the post up there where the crowds are. And it's just unexplainable, you know. These are players you think that they have potential. They're supposed to, you know, lift Chelsea alongside with the manager. But there's only little the manager can do. At this point in time, I also to extend the blame to the players as well. I don't think they have lived up to expectations, and some of the players have been, you know, trying their best, but at the end of the day, the players that were brought in have not lived up to expectations.
All right, let's remind you again, you can call us 07-00-923-923-923. You can also send messages on WhatsApp 08-1-7313-6193. 08-1-7313-6193. We're also live on Facebook at Inspiration FM 92.3. Just leave your comments under the live feed, we'll read them on the show. Let's go to WhatsApp first. Yomi from Ikorodu says, good morning, guys. It's now clear as ever that the problem of Chelsea is the owners. Clueless lots spent billions on a bunch of average kids and expect world-class performances from them. They probably think real life is like FIFA or Football Manager. Todd will surely get what is coming to him one way or another.
Anthony, Brighton, We spent a lot of money on kids.
Mm.
But it's bearing fruit these days.
So exactly.
So now my excuse. So let's just forget that.
I'll come to Chipolo in a bit because I know Chipolo is itching to say something. So Chipolo, you look, there's something you've been saying, and you know, I think I agree with you actually. Chelsea's problems have been a long time coming. It didn't just start this season. I mean, the goal scoring problems have been there, defensive problems have been there, creative problems have been there. So it's not just Pochettino's problem. A lot of other managers before Pochettino have, you know, experienced these issues. Why have these issues not been sorted out?
Well, first and foremost, I must say that let's just clear things out. Mm. Since Diego Costa left Chelsea, the goal scoring has become a problem.
Mm.
But other managers have found a way to go around that problem by getting other players to score goals. After Diego Costa left, I remember there was Tammy Abraham and Olivier Giroud. Tammy Abraham scored about 14 to 15 league goals that season, and he was cheap. He was shipped out. The season Chelsea won the Champions League, goal scoring was also the problem under Thomas Tuchel.
Okay.
And that was why they went to go bring Romelu Lukaku the following season. Then Lukaku did his, you know, Kalu and everything. Then they had to, you know, abandon Lukaku. Timo Werner left. Kai Havertz became the first nine, and the problem persisted, led to the sacking of Graham Potter. Lampard came in, he has also gone. Now, where I have problem is quickly the manager. We saw interviews, post match comments from managers.
Let's not go there. Let's not go there.
Anthony, I will go there. Anthony, I will go there. Anthony, I will go there. Let me go there.
Stop talking.
Roberto Di Zerbi. Brighton lost 3-1.
They won.
And they won 3-1. And he complained that this is the worst performance under him. They came from behind to score 3-1. 3-1. What's his name? Pep Guardiola. His team won. He said he lashed Rodri for the record he got.
Even if you know, I know he said something about Aston Villa yesterday.
Arteta drew 2-2. He's not happy. I'm not saying Poch is happy that he lost, but guess what Poch said? We were good. We were not excellent, but we were good.
It's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress.
Anyway, look, you make them to become comfortable, to be relaxed, to make these errors over and over. He's not going to score the goals. But if they know he's going to lash them, if they know he's going to be very hard on them, they'll be more serious playing on the field of play. There's no seriousness from these Chelsea boys.
Not to put, you know, any fear in the heart of any Chelsea fan out there, but this is your schedule coming up very soon. You play Fulham.
Fulham and Burnley.
Yeah, you play Fulham in midweek. Then you play Burnley.
Fulham next week.
You play Brighton, first of all, in the EFL Cup. Then you play Fulham. Then you play Burnley. Mm-hmm. And this is where it gets really, really hectic. There's Arsenal on the 21st of October. There's Brentford on the 28th of October. There's Tottenham on the 6th of November. There's Man City on the 12th of November. Wow. There's Newcastle on the 25th of November. Wow. There's Brighton again on the 2nd of December. Fire. There's Manchester United on the 6th of December. So this is a hectic schedule. I wish Chelsea fans were. I'm moving on from Chelsea. Let's go to Manchester United, buddy. I know I always say all win is a win. A win is a win is a win.
Mm-hmm.
But as a United fan, there's no way you can be satisfied with that performance from United at the weekend. Kudos to them for getting 3 points. I mean, I will take it any day of the week.
That's the most important.
But that performance for a newly promoted side, getting dominated like that, I think that's not doesn't inspire too much confidence in United.
Yeah, it doesn't. But again, a win can inspire confidence. When the team is in disarray at this point in time, you'd expect such performances. But with every match day and a win, the players begin to understand the fact that, okay, we can actually win games. If United are lost, people will still come here to complain. But at this point in time, 3 points are 3 points.
At the end of the day.
You understand? Yeah,
cool. And then Nicolas, the North London Derby, a fair result at the end of the day. 2-2 ended. I think none of the managers can complain about how it ended up.
Well, Anthony, I think the manager that should be grateful has to be Postecoglou, because the last time they won at Emirates Stadium was 13 years ago. Mm. So it's a whole lot, and it was like a big test for the coach. The fact that he's leading this team away from Harry Kane, I think it was a decent result, and we saw them come back immediately just after every each goal. The last one by Son was just, you know, absolutely fantastic. Before we could even, you know, sit down from jubilation and celebrating, there comes the equaliser. I think it was a game that was interesting to watch, and Stanley did not allow us watching that game. game because we have to watch the Arsenal game. We paid the price. At the end of the day, I was entertained.
You enjoyed this video? Hit the subscribe button for more. Leave a comment and like. Thank you.